Guess already had it on, maybe. Yep, it's already on. Look at that. Good morning and welcome to worship on this great day. It's not snowing, it's not sleeting, it's not freezing rain out.
Yet.
And, hey.
Don't mess with Mother Nature.
It's a beautiful day. Yeah, smacking with your cane there. Yeah. It's a beautiful day outside. It's not, the wind's not blowing 30 miles an hour and it's below zero or anything. So I think we got a lot to be thankful for this morning. So just welcome to worship this morning. I think there's only one announcement for the day, and that's that the staff parish wants to meet just for a few minutes right after the worship service. Oh, and there's another announcement. There's also, I believe there's some pastries that are in the side room as well. So, store-bought, of course. Are there any other announcements, girls? I know you're not going to be here at prayer time. Did you have something you want to bring up this morning for your prayer requests? Oh, they are going to be here. All right. Well, let's open our worship in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please join me in the call to worship. Keep me, God. You are my safety, my only happiness. I delight in fidelity. Those who chase other gods bring troubles upon themselves. When they pour out blood offerings and praise the names of idols, I will not join them. You, God, are all I have. Everything depends on you. You guide me. You teach my heart, O God. I will bless you. I will think of you always, mindful of your presence, O God, my strength. You will not abandon me or leave me among the dead. No, you will lead me to life, to endless joy, at your right hand forever. Our opening hymn is number 294, Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed?
Fingers or four fingers and two thumbs, right? Opposable thumbs. Oh, makes us unique from all those other animals, right? We can do a lot of things with these hands, right? We can twiddle our thumbs or make funny gestures at people or whatever we want to do with those. But that also means that we can do some pretty constructive things, doesn't it? We can do some pretty constructive things with those. But also, it means that we can also do some pretty destructive things as well. And when we stop and think about all those things that we could do at this time of Lent, that's where we're coming to God and asking His forgiveness this morning for all those things that we haven't necessarily done right, or which could include the things we've done wrong, or the things that we probably should have done, like helping someone out when they needed some help, and we just didn't, oh, somebody else will get to it someday, right? And those type of things as well, so not just the sins of commission that we do, but those things that we don't do that we probably should have done, those sins of omission as well. And so this morning, we're going to be talking more about Nicodemus and his role and what he did with his hands as we progress later in the service this morning. But next, we'll have our scripture, our prayer for illumination, and our scripture readings.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. God in heaven, we lift our hands in prayer to you. We should offer you our hearts and say, we have sinned. We have rebelled against you. You respond by telling us, my servant will succeed. He will be given great praise and the highest honors. Make us worthy to worship you, O Lord. Open our ears and hearts to receive your message today. Amen. Okay, the Old Testament reading this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 41, verses 8 through 13. But you, Israel, my servant Jacob, whom I have chosen, the offspring of Abraham, my friend, you whom I took from the ends of the earth and called from its farthest corners, saying to you, you are my servant. I have chosen you and not cast you off. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. Yes, all who are incensed against you shall be ashamed and disgraced. Those who strive against you shall be as nothing and shall perish. You shall seek those who contend with you, but you shall not find them. Those who war against you shall be as nothing at all. For I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. It is I who say to you, do not fear, I will help you. The epistle reading this morning comes from Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 26. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by His blood, effective through faith. He did this to show His righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that He Himself is righteous and that He justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Pam. Would you be in a word of prayer with me this morning? Gracious Lord, we just ask that you be with us this morning, that you fill us with your Holy Spirit, and Lord, especially for me, so that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart are known to be your words and not mine. Amen. You know, as I said, we were going to talk about a little bit more about Nicodemus today, and the way I'm going to present this today is kind of an interview. So we're having an interview with Nicodemus this morning. And so the question was, so Nicodemus, can you tell us in your own words what went on with Jesus? And he starts out, it was a snake that started it all. And we all know that. You know, that serpent who cost us everything, our place in paradise, and drove us out into the wilderness. Oh, that snake. You know, and another snake was also used to help me understand that saying, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, the teacher once told me, when I had gone to see him at night, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. You know, I didn't get it at that time, he said. Standing at that foot of the cross, though, I see now what it means. Perhaps I should have known before, you know, because after all, I am regarded as a great teacher of Israel. I know you don't know much about me, but the people of Jerusalem sure did. And I was born into one of the most prominent and wealthiest families in the holy city. My father was a strong and influential man, and that is how we got where we did. And I, his favored son, Nicodemus, well, I was not what my father wanted me to be, quite honestly. He tried to make me strong. If I were to become influential, I would need status in the religious life of my people. He said, you must become a Pharisee, my father told me over and over again. And then, with his money behind me a little bit, we must get you elected into the Sanhedrin, he said. And of course, I was. But in all truthfulness, I was nothing like my father, whose strong will, powerful, outspoken as a leader. No, the truth is, I avoided any of that possible conflict and confrontation. I just wasn't good at that. I found my security in just going along with the crowd. And as I now stand here in this crowd at the foot of the cross, I know who I am and what I am. A coward. I had the power and the influence. I had the voice, the opportunity to speak out. I could have stopped this crucifixion, or at least I could have tried. But they were all like snakes in the grass. It was 3 a.m. when they called, in the dead of night. Word came to me by a messenger, already winded from running up and down the midnight streets of Jerusalem. A special meeting of the council of the Sanhedrin, he cried off and ran. Now that was illegal, and they knew it. We were not allowed to meet at such an hour. What could be so important to demand a breach of the rules like this? I would object, I told myself as I came rushing in. And then I saw Jesus of Nazareth. But why was he here, hands bound? Where were his followers? I recognized him, of course, the teacher. I had seen him before, once as a matter of fact, and I realized it was something of an uncharacteristic moment for me, when soldiers had been sent to bring Jesus to the council, and they came back empty-handed. I did, in a way, stand up for him. I said, does our law judge a man before he hears him? I asked, and they turned on me and snarled, are you a Galilean too? That was enough, and it just stopped me cold. I feared saying anything more. So now, before this illegal session, there was no way I was going to speak up. No way at all. They already knew what they wanted. Death. And they would get their way. As I watched and listened as Caiaphas, acting less like God's high priest and more like some crazed maniac, kept charging along. He kept probing, kept asking, kept accusing, searching in some way, looking for some opening, someone to testify. But it was to no avail, until in desperation, Caiaphas faced Jesus head on. Calling a halt to everything else, he cried out, "Enough of this! There is really only one issue at stake, and it's simply this. Answer me under oath of the supreme God of Israel and tell us, are you the Son of God as you claim?" The silence was heavy, as if it were waiting to crack under its own weight. For if he answered yes, he would surely die as a blasphemer. They waited, and into the silence he proclaimed, "I am." Caiaphas, like a man out of his own mind, tore at his robe, ripping it at its hem, and the sign of unbearable grief and horror of that time, crying out at the same time, "Blasphemy! Blasphemy! You heard him! All of you heard him! What more of a witness do we need? He is guilty of death. Death, I say." I heard it, and I said not a word. I was frozen with fear at what would happen to me. I was froze with a coward's fear. But no more. Today I will become a poor man among my people. Today I will become an outcast. Once they hear that I have accepted him, once they know that I too believed in him, the Son of God, Savior, they will cast me out and seek to destroy me too. But here, at the foot of his cross, the picture is becoming clear. As I looked up at him hanging there on the cross, his words came rushing back to me. That night, over a year ago, under the cover of darkness, I had crept up into his rooftop to talk with him. I had heard so much, and so much that had puzzled me, and now I just had to know him. He sounded like one from God, but what did he really mean when he said those words? What did he possibly could mean when he spoke to me? "Born again," he said, "born again of water and the Spirit." You know, some things he said now have become quite clear and quite visible to me. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And that glorious promise, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send me into this world to condemn it, but that the world might be saved through him." I once again was blind, but now I see. And what I see is how foolish I was to cringe here in pain over my own cowardice and not even try to stop the crucifixion. He did not want me to save him. He came to save me and all who would believe in him, and that the world might be saved through him. I am ashamed of my cowardice, but a coward I am no more. I will not slither like a serpent. With my friend Joseph of Arimathea, I will claim his body, and we will carry him to rest in the grave. This is my Savior, And though we lay him in the tomb, his words still echo hope. I am the resurrection and the life. I go to prepare a place for you. The time of silence is now over, and the time of fear and cowardice gone. For such he died. Now is the time to speak. What have you seen in secret? Proclaim openly, he said once. And I called him on a secret once, in darkness and in fear and in arrogance and in ignorance. You must be born again, he said, of water and the Spirit. Be born again. And I am. And that is why I now speak boldly. The serpent will not have the final word. And that was his end of his interview that he gave that day to those that were listening. So that begs of us. Jesus stood up for us, didn't he? Are we like cowards, like the early Nicodemus? Are we too afraid to open our mouths and to speak the truth of God's love to someone? Or are we bold and willing to go out and dare that ridicule we might get, that dare to say, you know, I believe in God and God is my Lord. Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Because remember, in the end, the serpent will not have the final word. Jesus is, as he says, I am the resurrection, the truth, and the life. And then that second phrase that was uttered by Nicodemus, Jesus said, I go and prepare a place for you. He's still here. Only his body died, but he is still here and still alive today. Are we living and acting like that in our own lives? Amen. Would you be in an attitude of prayer with me? Gracious Lord, we just ask that you give us the strength and the courage to be bold for you, Lord. And finally, Lord, we just ask that you give us that strength and courage and then present opportunities to us to be able to go out and to learn of those that need your healing love and grace so that we too can be bold and tell of your news to them so that they too may believe. Amen. Let's join in our hymn of response this morning. It's to the tune of Southwell, and it's entitled, Our Savior Speaks in Grace. Sense, but also our pledge to him for him to use us as he sees fit in service to him and his kingdom. As we think about that and all the blessings that he gives, let's give glory to our God this morning through our doxology. the gifts that you give us. And Father, we just ask that you bless these tithes and offerings which we have presented to you. May you bless them so that when combined with others from around the state and nation that and the world, that they can be used to help those in need of healing and comfort, so that they can see your face shining at them and know how much that you love them. May it be used to help sponsor those that go out as missionaries into the world in various parts, so that they too can spread your news of how your love transforms even us, even someone who has denied Christ at times, someone who has not been in a relationship with him, but he simply transforms not just his believers, but those that didn't even know him before. So Lord, help us to enable these things through the gifts of our tithes and offerings. Amen. It's time to lift up our prayer request this morning. What joys and concerns do we have today? So you might have noticed Michelle isn't here with me this morning. She started not feeling well and kind of got a little sick when she was here, so she went home. I think it's mainly just drainage. She's been a little stuffy the last couple days, so nothing serious, it looks like. So anything else? Yes.
I would like prayers for Brian and Lee Maxwell's children. Brian passed away 3 weeks ago, and unfortunately, his wife and one of the children passed away 2 days ago. So those kids are now without parents.
Wow. So for Brian and Leah Maxwell's kids who are now parentless in a very short period of time. So just we just lift them up to God and to his tender care. And let us be those hands and feet that care about them and pray and lift them up in prayer. Other prayer requests? Yes. So for the people in Texas that were without power, and some cities were without water because it was freezing up on them, you know, they're not used to that cold weather down there. I think it's something like 1897 or something like that was the last time it got that cold, or they got that the temperatures dipped down that much. So they're not used to that at all, and so a lot of things were kind of going wrong in Texas for them. And then also that same storm system spawned some tornadoes, I guess, in the Carolinas as well. So we'll also pray for those that were affected by those. Any others? All right, the girls did tell me a prayer request that Gracie's softball team continues to do well, that they played yesterday and are playing later today, and they just hope that she continues to do well. So. Oh, their prayer request was from Rochelle. Okay. All right. All right. Anything else this morning? All right. Let's center our thoughts on our prayer course this morning. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Gracious Lord, we come before you this day and looking for your comfort and peace. Father, we just give you thanks for the beautiful day in which you have created and for getting us up and getting us going this morning. And Lord, we also have many prayer requests as we come before you. We lift up the children of Brian and Leah Maxwell, Lord, who have gone from having two loving parents with them to having no parents at all in the last several weeks or to a month. And Lord, we just lift them up to your tender care. Father, we have no concept of what that can be like, but you do, Father God. And so we just ask your loving grace upon them to wrap your loving arms around those kids and let them know that you are with them through this. And Father, let others that provide comfort be your hands and feet for them in this world so that they can come to know that you love them even through this tragedy that they're going through. And Father, we lift up those that were in Texas and had so much ice and snow and cold temperatures that they haven't seen for over 100 years, Lord. And we just ask that you be with them as they restore power and Lord, help them to move on forward and not to look at the past, but look forward to where they need to go from here on out. And Father, we also know that same storm system created some tornadoes in the Carolinas, and there's damage from those. So Lord, just be with those people in the Carolinas that were affected by those tornadoes and those heavy storms and wind that came through for them as well. Father, we lift all these things up to your tender care and mercy and grace as we join in the prayer which your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's join in our closing hymn, Chief of Sinners Though I Be. Receive God's benediction for you this day. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. And remember, your hands. What can you do with them? Amen. Thank you.